हेलो, गुड आफ्टरनून। हेलो हेलो, गुड आफ्टरनून। एम आई ऑडिबल? हेलो,
यस सर।
वी वुड जॉइन और वेट, एम आई वेट फॉर सम टाइम। हेलो,
सर यू कैन स्टार्ट।
कैन आई स्टार्ट?
यस सर।
ओके, पावर पॉइंट विजिबल?
यस सर।
Okay, and today's topic of discussion is UBA. This is the second part of the UBA. Okay, last day we discussed about the clinical feature, differential diagnosis, and classification, etiology, etc. Okay, so today's point of discussion, first point of discussion is the where should I prescribe the investigation? In all cases, should I prescribe the investigation for uveitis? No, in all cases of uveitis, investigation not required. It is required only in some cases. It is not prescribed in first attack of activities or any uveitis associated with a particular systemic disease or any particular type of uveitis like sympathetic uveitis, etc. So regarding the investigation, the first point is the hematological investigation. These are the total count, differential count, erythrocyte sedimentation rate, which mainly it signifies the any acute inflammation inside the body. Now the second point is the blood sugar level. It is associated with the any presence of any diabetes, blood uric acid level, which is associated with any gout. And regarding the serological test for syphilis like VDRL, toxoplasmosis, any anti treponemal antibody test, histoplasmosis, any anti histoplasmin test. Okay. And the blood for antinuclear antibody, Rh factor, LE cells, C reactive protein, anti-streptolysin O titer, and AC levels are also important. AC levels are mainly associated with any granulomatous uveitis, like associated with any sarcoidosis. Now the urine examination is mainly for routine and microscopical and any culture sensitivity test for urine. Stool examination for ova and parasite. Radiological examinations are chest X-ray, X-ray paranasal sinus, X-ray sacroiliac joint, for any presence of any spondyloarthrosis. CT scan thorax for any sarcoidosis or any tuberculosis. MRI brain for any neurocystic sarcosis or any other association. The skin test are the Mantu test for tuberculosis, Bhim test, toxoplasmin test, leprosin test for leprosy, and pathology test for Behçet's disease. Now the treatment of the uveitis. What is the mainstay of treatment for uveitis? So now the regarding medical treatment, corticosteroid is the mainstay of treatment for uveitis. Corticosteroid mainly given, may be given periocularly, like posterior subtenon injection of the depot steroid, maybe intravitreally or maybe systemic, like oral or any systemic route. The topic regarding corticosteroid topically, most preferred drug is the prednisolone acetate 1%. Prednisolone is emulsified form, so you have to ask the patient to take use. Now, what is the mainstay of treatment? It is the for acute anterior uveitis. The mainstay of treatment is the prednisolone acetate 1% eye drops, which can be given eight times, 10 times, may be given as frequent as 1 hourly or half hourly according to the severity of the disease. Periocular depot steroid are mainly prescribed in cases of the intermediate uveitis, and in case of posterior uveitis we prescribe the intravitreal depot steroid or systemic steroid. Second line of therapy is the second drug is the cycloplegic. Cycloplegic is most important in cases of uveitis. Cytoplegic, we prefer atropine sulfate 1% eye drop, or in children below 10 years of age, eye ointment. Okay, cytoplegic, the atropine is given 2 to 3 times per day. The atropine sulfate, it has mainly actions. The importance are it prevents the posterior synechia formation or may break the already formed posterior synechia. It may improve the vascularization to the uveal tissue, so the antibody may be poured out into the anterior chamber. Okay, the two mainstay of treatment is the corticosteroid and cycloplegic. Corticosteroid, prednisolone acetate 1% eye drop, and cycloplegic, this is the atropine sulfate 1% eye drop or eye ointment. If the prednisolone if the corticosteroid are resistant or corticosteroid are contraindicated, then we may prescribe the systemic immunosuppression like azathioprine, cyclosporine, cyclophosphamide, clonbucil, etc. If there is secondary increase of the IOP, so we can prescribe the topical anti-glaucoma. These are the tumoral maleate given other bromonidine. But one thing you have to remember, pilocarpine pilocarpine and the prostaglandin analogs are contraindicated in cases of inflammatory type of block. So we prescribe the beta blocker, we prescribe acetazolamide. Surgery is required if there is presence of complicated cataract, presence of secondary glaucoma, or vitreoretinal procedure in cases of vitreous traction band, etc. Physical measures are the hot fomentation, which improves the surface perioculary and may soothe the eye, and the dark goggles may also helpful to decrease the photophobia. So these are the mainstay of treatment of acute anterior uveitis. The mainstay of treatment is the corticosteroid and cycloplegic. Now, regarding the intermediate uveitis is the inflammation of the pars plana, part of the ciliary body. That is the past penalties and associated HGS case. Now the intermediate, in cases of intermediate uveitis, 80% cases are idiopathic, and the remaining other causes are tuberculosis, sarcoidosis, syphilis. Now the symptoms are, many cases it is asymptomatic, or patients may have confluence of floaters, that is the black spot floating or rounding in the visual field, or may in late cases, if the central part of the vitreous is involved, then there may be presence of decreased vision. Regarding thymus, we may see the vitreous cells in the anterior vitreous body and the vitreous condensation in the vitreous cavity. There may be small opacities in the inferior part of the vitreous and snow banking at the ora serrata. Snow banking is the pathognomonic for the intermediate, or there may be presence of severe vitreous opacification. During treatment, intermediate uveitis is treated with perioocular or systemic steroids. Perioocular steroids are posterior substendent steroids, depot steroids, which may be triamcinolone acetate, we give in a Nodic technique. Now regarding immune, if the systemic steroids like oral or systemic steroids are contraindicated or not life-threatening, then we can give the immunosuppressant agents like azathioprine, cyclosporine, chlorambucil, etc. In cases of unresponsive cases, there may be cryotherapy or indirect laser photocoagulation may be helpful. Or in last sort of treatment is the Parsmana vitrectomy. The posterior uveitis. Posterior uveitis is the inflammation of the choroid with associated retina. That is choroiditis or chorioretinitis. It may be infectious or it may be non-infectious. In case of infectious, it may be tuberculosis, it may be sarcoidosis, it may be toxoplasma, which may give rise to the posterior uveitis. There may be non-infectious cases of many autoimmune diseases. The symptoms are mainly the posterior uveitis are asymptomatic, or if it may involve the posterior pole of the retina or choroid, then it may be symptoms like decreased vision. There may be photopsia, that is the flashes of light present in the visual field, maybe floaters, that is the presence of black spots in the visual field. There may be presence of metamorphopsia, that is the perception of the distorted image. This may be due to the elevation of the retina after accumulation of the exudate inside the retina. There may be micropsia, where the objects minimize or perceives a minification of the objects due to separation of the photoreceptor cells. There may be macropsia, the objects are perceived a larger size, and this is may be due to the crowding of the photoreceptor cells. There is positive scotoma, which is the fixed black spot in the visual field. These are the main visual symptoms of the posterior uveitis. Regarding signs, there may be vitreous opacity. This is the whitening of the vitreous. There may be active patches of choroiditis, which is in active stages, it is seen as a yellowish fluffy spots inside the retina with blurring of the margins. If there is healed, the choroid is healed, then the margins are discrete, and the inside the choroiditis there may be hyperpigmented, or sclera may be seen through the damaged retina and choroid, and at the margins of the choroiditis patch there is pigmentation. Regarding treatment, the posterior uveitis is treated with perioocular or systemic steroid. Perioocular is the posterior substendent depot steroid. Systemic steroid are oral steroids. If the systemic steroid are contraindicated, then immunosuppressive drugs like azathioprine, cyclophosphamide, chlorambucil may be present. In cases of specific treatment, if it is associated with any specific disease like tuberculosis or any other disease, then the disease may be treated. This is a picture of choroiditis with hyperpigmentation inside and the hyperpigmentation at the margin. Now the sympathetic ophthalmitis, it is a specific bilateral granulomatous panuveitis following a penetrating ocular injury. The etiology is not known, but mainly the any penetrating injury with incapacitated iris tissue may lead to sympathetic ophthalmitis. The pathogenesis is not clear, but the allergy theory is most important. In this of sympathetic ophthalmitis, it is believed that there is formation of antibody against the uveal pigment tissue, which may comments the granulomatous uveitis. Regarding clinical features in the exciting eye, that is the injured eye, there may be presence of ciliary congestion, there may be presence of lacrimation or any tenderness. The sympathetic eye, usually there is presence of uveitis 4 to 8 years after the injury. Now, in prodromal stage, there may be presence of photophobia, weakening of the accommodation. There may be presence of retroviral interfere, which is the earliest sign of the sympathetic ophthalmitis, and there may be presence of few KPs. In fully developed stage, there is features of acute uveitis, that is the presence of maybe presence of hypopia, maybe presence of cells and flares inside the anterior chamber. Now, the regarding treatment, regarding prophylaxis, if there is no chance of any saving the vision, then the excision of the injured eye is the mainstay of the treatment. If there is any chance of saving the vision, then the meticulous repair of the uveal tissue along with steroids and antibiotics are the mainstay of treatment. Now, in case of treatment of this, the early enucleation of the injured eye is the mainstay of the treatment. Now, regarding other treatments, are the corticosteroids. If corticosteroid is contraindicated, there may be immunosuppressive drugs like azathioprine, cyclophosphamide, and there may be atropine may be prescribed like cyclophysic drug. Voght-Koyanagi-Harada syndrome, it is an idiopathic multisystem disorder. It includes skin, nerve, ear, and the ocular lesion. In case of Voght-Koyanagi-Harada syndrome, it is believed that there is autoantibody formation against the melanocyte. So the melanocyte containing organs are mostly damaged. In skin lesions, there may be presence of alopecia, there may be polyosis, which is the whitening of the eyelashes, there may be presence of vitiligo. In neurological lesions, there may be presence of meningism, encephalopathy. In auditory lesions, there may be presence of tinnitus, vertigo, and deafness. In ophthalmological cases, there may be presence of anterior uveitis, there is bilateral chronic granulomatous uveitis. In posterior uveitis, there may be presence of multifocal choroiditis with exudative retinal detachment and choroidal depigmentation. In treatment, it is treated with oral corticosteroid. If corticosteroid are contraindicated, then immunosuppressive drugs are prescribed. This is a case of Voght-Koyanagi-Harada syndrome where the polyosis is seen, that is the whitening of the eyelashes. Now the endophthalmitis, it is the inflammation of the inner structure of the eye. That is the inflammation of the choroid and retina with pouring of the exudate inside the eyeball. Now the etiology, it may be infective, it may be non-infective. In infective endophthalmitis, it may be bacterial, may be fungal, and the infection may be exogenous, where the organism get entry from a outside source, in the trauma, it may be any surgical instrument, or it may be endogenous, or endogenous from the may be endogenous from the surrounding tissue, or it may be secondary from a distant source of. In non-infective endophthalmitis, it may be secondary to any operation, that is the post-operative, it may be post-traumatic, it may be phacoanaphylactic, where the lens proteins are floating inside the anterior, or it may be secondary to any intraocular tumor necrosis. The clinical features, the symptoms are severe pain, redness, lacrimation, photophobia, and dimness of vision. In the regarding signs, there may be presence of edema, there may be conjunctival chemosis and congestion, cornea may be edematous, cloudy, and there may be presence of ring infiltrate. The anterior chambers, there may be presence of hypopia with cells and fear. The iris may be edematous and muddy. The pupil is, there may be presence of yellow reflex due to presence of exudation in the vitreous cavity. And there may be, pupil may be Paget's reaction. In vitreous, there may be presence of exudate where the white reflex is present. IOP may be raised in early cases, but in severe cases, where the all ocular structures are damaged, the IOP becomes very low and eye becomes sunken and cyclical. Regarding treatment, intravitreal antibiotics and vitreous tap are the mainstay of treatment. Regarding intravitreal antibiotics, intravitreal ceftazidime, intravitreal vancomycin are the drug of choice. Intravitreal amikacin, intravitreal cefazolin may be. Topical concentrated antibiotics like fortified cefazolin, fortified vancomycin, and fortified ceftazidime may be given. Systemic antibiotics are broad spectrum antibiotics are given intravenously or orally. Steroid therapy is controversial. Some scientists may prefer to give steroid after 48 hours of intensive antibiotic therapy. Some may prefer to give the steroid in the earlier stages to prevent the inflammation. Cycloplegic drugs like atropine sulfate may be given drop, or in cases of below 10 years may be given ointment 2 to 3 times. Analgesic drugs are non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs are given. If the IOP is high, some hope to save the vision, and there is lots of exudation inside the vitreous cavity, then we go for the vitrectomy. Now the panophthalmitis, it is the intense purulent inflammation of the whole eyeball, where the three layers of the eyeballs are involved, including Cannon's capsule. The etiology is same as the bacterial endophthalmitis, may be exogenous, may be endogenous, or may be secondary. Regarding symptoms, there may be presence of severe pain, there may be presence of loss of vision, presence of discharge and swelling of the eyeball. Regarding signs, there is presence of marked lid edema, eyeball is proptosed, and movement is limited and restricted because of the involvement of the ophthalmic muscles. The conjunctiva is chemosed and congested, and cornea is cloudy and edematous. The anterior chamber is full of pus, there is presence of full of pus, and vision is completely lost, and IOP is markedly raised. Regarding treatment, the anti-inflammatory and analgesic drugs are given along with broad-spectrum antibiotic. Evisceration is the mainstay of treatment. So, thank you. This is all about the uvea. So, I have completed the whole uvea. So, any questions? Should I conclude? Hello.
Sir.
Hello.